Medieval Archives Podcast, Lesson 53. Welcome back to the Medieval Archives Podcast, the podcast for medieval news, history, and entertainment. I'm your host, Gary, a.k.a. The Archivist. This month, we're approaching a major milestone. This month's milestone has to do with the Kingdom of Scotland, and this one holds a little more meaning this year than in the past. Now, the anniversary is the Battle of Bannockburn, pitting Scotland against England, and the winner gets to rule Scotland. So today, we're going to look at the events leading up to the battle and some of the major players involved. Now, if you want to keep up to date with Medieval Archives, consider subscribing to our email list. Now, whenever there's a post on the site or I add a new podcast lesson, you'll be one of the first to know. You'll also be the first to hear about any special announcements. So don't miss out. Head on over to medievalarchives.com/subscribe to sign up now. Now, if you have a question or comment, or if you have any topic that you're just dying to hear on the show, send them over to podcast@medievalarchives.com. Or you can leave a message on the listener feedback line, 720-722-1066. Now, if you're enjoying the podcast, please consider leaving us a ratings over on iTunes. It's an easy way to support the show, and it helps others find it while they're searching for great historic content. It's real simple. Point your browser to medievalarchives.com/iTunes, leave a rating, and if you have the time, leave a little review as well. Thanks to everyone who's left all the great reviews and ratings over on iTunes. All right, so all the stuff we discussed today on the First War of Scottish Independence is going to be in the lesson plan, and you can find that lesson plan at medievalarchives.com/53. So with that, let's get into the First War of Scottish Independence. Now, for all intents, the Battle of Bannockburn ended the First War of Scottish Independence. It pretty much ended all the wars of Scottish Independence. But today we want to look at the events leading up to the battle, what took place after the battle, and how the Scots were able to secure their independence. Now, that First War of Scottish Independence, along with the Second, helped secure Scotland's independence for another 400 years. It wasn't until 1707 that Scotland came under the official rule of England. The Treaty of Union in 1707 created the United Kingdom of Great Britain. Now, at the beginning, I said that this year is even more important than years past. And not only is this year the 700th anniversary of the battle, but later this year, on 18 September, Scotland is going to vote on the Scottish independence referendum. Now, if that passes, Scotland will be an independent country once again. But before we get into the current events, let's jump back to the 14th century and see how the war began. Let's look at how Scotland was able to defeat the might of England and of King Edward I, dubbed the Hammer of the Scots. The First War started during a succession crisis in Scotland. King Alexander III died in 1286, and his three-year-old granddaughter Margaret was the heir to the throne. Now, Margaret's mother, also named Margaret, she married King Eric II of Norway. And so the younger Margaret, who was known as the Maid of Norway, was now the Queen of the Scots. But not all the Scottish nobles accepted the girl as their queen. John Balliol and John Comyn, known as the Red Comyn, moved to take action against Queen Margaret and to put John Balliol on the throne. But Robert Bruce, now not the famous King Robert the Bruce, this is Robert Bruce, the 5th Lord of Annandale. He was the grandfather of the future King Robert the Bruce. So Robert, Lord of Annandale, he helped secure key strongholds and raised an army to fight in the name of Margaret. Now Bruce was able to stop the rebellion, and by 1289, the Guardians of Scotland maintained a truce between the competing factions. Now the Guardians of Scotland are simply noblemen who acted as the heads of state when there wasn't a sitting king or queen. So in 1289, Scotland's queen is a young girl, and the nobles are under a stressed peace trying to position themselves as the next king. Now, all the while, Queen Margaret is still in Norway with her father, King Eric, and the Scottish nobles aren't in a big hurry for her to arrive in Scotland. But King Eric, he's not waiting around. He sends an ambassador to King Edward I of England and begins to negotiate the marriage of Margaret to Edward's son, Prince Edward, who's going to be the future King Edward II. Now, these negotiations completely exclude the Scots. And King Edward finally started talking to the Scots, the Guardians of Scotland, and they met with King Edward, and they all agreed on the Treaty of Salisbury. The treaty provided safe passage for Margaret to England, where she would stay under the protection of King Edward until the troubles in Scotland had settled down. And it also ended any talk of marriage between Margaret and Prince Edward. Edward agreed to this treaty. I mean, he's the one that brought it up. But he had no intention of holding to it. He petitioned the Pope to sanction the marriage. And 10 days after the treaty, the Pope sanctioned the marriage through a papal bull. All the negotiation and scheming would eventually fall apart in October of 1290. Margaret, who at the age of 7 years old, died on the Orkney Islands while traveling back to Scotland. Her death would lead to a bigger succession crisis than the death of King Alexander. At the time of her death, there were no less than 14 noblemen that stepped up and claimed the throne of Scotland, one of them even being King Edward from England. Edward's claim was pretty weak. Even he knew that. But it was about as good as most of the other claimants. Now, the two men who held the best claim on the throne was John Balliol and Robert Bruce. Now, both men claimed the line through their wives, who were the great-granddaughters of King David I of Scotland. Now, Balliol thought his claim was stronger since his wife was the firstborn. Now, the Guardians of Scotland, to avoid an all-out civil war, ended up inviting the wolf into the hen house. They asked King Edward to settle this dispute. Now, while in this great position, Edward made a few demands on the Scots. He wanted the Scots to recognize that the Kingdom of Scotland was a feudal state dependent on the Kingdom of England, essentially setting up Scotland as a vassal state to England. The Guardians of Scotland weren't quite that desperate yet. They told King Edward that without a king, the Scots would be unable to declare Edward the overlord of Scotland. Edward was upset about this, but he was undeterred. He won a few of the Scottish nobles over to his side, and they declared their allegiance to him. So Edward made his decision in November of 1292, declaring John Balliol the rightful king of Scotland. But he also set up his son Prince Edward as the heir to the throne of Scotland. And then in December, King John of Scotland bowed before King Edward and swore homage to him. With that action, Edward declared Scotland a vassal state of England. And then 2 years later, Edward called on King John and Scotland to provide an army for his upcoming invasion of France. Now, not wanting to heed Edward's demands, King John assembled a council and then sent emissaries to France to warn the King of France of England's intentions of war. And secretly, France and Scotland signed an alliance, ensuring support that if England invaded either country, the other would come to their aid. This alliance was solidified with the marriage of John's son to the niece of the King of France, and that alliance is known as the Auld Alliance. In an interesting side note, that alliance is still in effect today. So Edward discovered this secret alliance between France and Scotland about early 1296, and he was ticked. He began to increase his troop strength along the northern border. Now Edward called on King John to turn over control of his castles, and Edward sent more troops north to take those castles. King John, for his part, didn't stand still. He called on his nobles to assemble an army to fight the English. But there are a few holdouts, one of which was Robert the Bruce, the future king this time. His grandfather had died in 1295, and his father had resigned in favor of the son in early 1296. So Robert the Bruce, who's the Earl of Carrick, was at odds with King John. See, King John had confiscated Bruce's estates at Carrick and gave them to John Comyn. But the Bruce wasn't completely without fault here. Up to this point, he was a bit of a flip-flopper. He was with the Scots, and then he turned to try his luck with the English to see if he'd have luck becoming the next king of Scotland with English backing. And when that didn't work out, he went back to the Scottish side. So while the Scots were still fighting amongst themselves, the English marched north and devastated the border town of Berwick-upon-Tweed, killing over 10,000 Scottish men, women, and children. Now, the capture of Berwick and the bloody massacre is the beginning of the first phase of the First War of Scottish Independence. And this was led by legendary men like Andrew de Moray, William Douglas, and of course, William Wallace. The second battle of this war was the Battle of Dunbar, which was another loss for the Scots, and England took over 100 prisoners, many of whom were Scottish nobles, including Andrew de Moray and King John. Now, John would abdicate the throne and remain a prisoner until 1299. And he was allowed to travel to France in 1299, and he never returned to Scotland. He died in France in 1314. After two losses in battle, the Scots would redeem themselves in a little over a year in September of 1297. They met the English at Stirling Bridge. Now, at the Battle of Stirling Bridge, the Scots were commanded by Andrew de Moray, who had been released from captivity, and William Wallace.
I am William Wallace. And I see a whole army of my countrymen here in defiance of tyranny. You've come to fight as free men. And free men you are.
The Scots were badly outnumbered. They were outnumbered about 4-1 in this battle. But they had a well-disciplined army, and they had very tactical leaders. What the Scots had on their side was the bottleneck of the battle, which was the River Forth crossing. The English could only cross at Stirling Bridge, but the bridge was narrow and could only hold two mounted knights side by side. Now, there was a Scottish knight who had turned and joined the English, and he suggested he take a group of knights and cross at a nearby ford and flank the Scottish army. But the English commanders rejected that idea, and they made a tactical error and ordered a full frontal assault on the Scots, forcing his army to march over the bridge with little to no support. So as the English started crossing the bridge, the Scots just waited until about a third of the English army had crossed the bridge, evening the odds just a bit. But can you imagine this? You're on the Scottish army and you're watching the enemy slowly march across the bridge, and then they get off the bridge and they spread out and start to organize right in front of you. I mean, it must have been tempting to kill them as they crossed the bridge. But Wallace and de Moray, they had a well-disciplined army, and they had a great tactical mind, and they knew what they were doing. Once the Scots finally attacked, the Scottish spearmen ravaged the English cavalry. The English lost about half of their men in that battle. They lost about 100 mounted knights and over 5,000 infantrymen. Now, one of the English commanders, Hugh Cressingham, was killed during the battle, and his skin was flayed off and cut into pieces as victory souvenirs. It's recorded in a contemporary chronicle that William Wallace cut a broad strip of Cressingham's skin, taken from the head to the heel, to make a baldric for his sword. And a baldric is a sash or like a leather belt, in this case leather made of human skin, and it goes over the shoulder and it's used to carry a sword. That's pretty gross. The English lost their fighting spirit in this battle when they witnessed Cressingham being cut to pieces by the Scots. And the English soldiers, they just started dumping their armor, jumping in the river, and swimming across. And the remaining English commander, the Earl of Surrey, he ordered the bridge destroyed and then a full-out retreat. Stirling Bridge was a massive defeat for the English. It exposed a weakness in their cavalry, and it was ineffective in close combat. The Scots even chased the English as they retreated. They destroyed their supply train, and they killed any of the retreating soldiers that they could. Now, the one major loss for the Scots in this battle was Andrew de Moray. He was wounded in the battle, and then a few weeks later, he died from those wounds. William Wallace was rewarded for the victory. He was made a guardian of Scotland. Over the next few months, Wallace attacked northern England. Now, these attacks didn't amount to much, but they kept the English on edge. Not real sure when or where the Scots were going to attack again. It was all guerrilla-type warfare, just quick attacks here, some quick attacks over there. The next major battle was at Falkirk in 1298, and Falkirk would pit William Wallace against the Hammer of the Scots, King Edward I. Now, this fight was a little more even. The Scots were only outnumbered 2-1 this time. At Falkirk, the English cavalry charged early before Edward had a chance to arrive and set up his command. And once Edward finally arrived, he recalled those knights and tried to restore discipline. Edward ordered his longbowmen to fire on the Scots first. Once the longbowmen started firing, John Comyn, over on the Scottish side, took his men-at-arms and left the battlefield. The Scottish cavalry stuck around a little longer, but not much. They fled and left the Scottish foot soldiers to fend for themselves. And the battle turned on the Scots quickly. The English longbowmen and crossbowmen fired on the Scots with great effect. Once that Scottish army was weakened, Edward ordered a full cavalry charge. The remaining Scottish army had little chance and they were easily beaten. A few of the Scottish leaders, including William Wallace, were able to retreat and avoid death or capture. But Falkirk was a major loss for the Scots. But it was a much-needed victory for King Edward and the English, who had suffered some defeats over in France. After the defeat at Falkirk, Wallace resigned as a guardian of Scotland and endorsed Robert the Bruce and John the Red Comyn. Now, despite what the movie Braveheart tells us, there's little known about the activities of William Wallace after Falkirk. There's a little bit of evidence that puts Wallace in France, and it wasn't to hook up with Queen Isabella, who was like 10 at the time. Most likely he was there trying to secure support from the King of France to help Scotland. But by 1304, Wallace was back in Scotland, and he was finally captured in 1305 and turned over to the English and tried for treason. Now, like the movie Braveheart, Wallace denied the charges of treason, saying Edward wasn't his king, that King John of Scotland was his official king. Wallace was found guilty of treason in August 1305 and taken to the Tower of London for execution. Wallace was hanged until he was almost dead. Then he was eviscerated, which means his bowels were cut out while he was still alive, and then he was beheaded. And then his body was cut into pieces. His head was dipped in tar to preserve it and then placed on the Tower Bridge. And the different pieces of his body were sent out and displayed across the country at Newcastle, at Berwick, at Stirling, and at Perth. Now, his execution and the display of his body parts were meant to deter the Scots from fighting the English, but it had the opposite effect. It fueled their nationalism and their hatred for the English. Now, after Falkirk, the Scots again were a divided nation between Robert the Bruce, who was now fully on the Scottish side, and John the Red Comyn. Now, between the Battle of Falkirk and the Battle of Bannockburn, there were 6 battles between the English and the Scots, and 3 battles between the Scots and the Scots, the Army of Bruce and the Army of Comyn. Now, the battles with England were technically a draw. Each side won 3 battles. However, England won more territory with those victories, and they even captured Stirling Castle. Now, the Scottish Civil War that had erupted between Bruce and Comyn would take a few years to sort out. But the rivalry between Bruce and Comyn would finally end on a cold winter's night in Dumfries. Now, before that night in Dumfries, Bruce and Comyn agreed on a truce for the security of the nation. And the agreement was for Comyn to support Bruce's claim to the Scottish throne, and then Bruce would give Comyn lands for payment. Now, it appears that Comyn, for whatever reason, was trying to double deal on the Bruce and told King Edward of the agreement, trying to undermine Bruce and seeing if Edward would make Comyn the king of Scotland. On 6 February 1306, Robert the Bruce and his men found John Comyn in the Dumfries Greyfriars Church. Now, Bruce confronted Comyn about the betrayal and to try and work out another negotiation. But tempers flared, and in a bout of anger, Bruce stabbed Comyn and then ran out of the church disheveled. Bruce saw his man Kirkpatrick outside and proclaimed, "I have killed Comyn." Kirkpatrick said, "You doubt? I'll make sukar," which means "I'll make sure." And then Kirkpatrick entered the church and finished off John Comyn. Now, after the murder of John Comyn, Bruce was in a tough spot. Not only was he a murderer, but he killed a man in church. His soul was in jeopardy. He was excommunicated immediately. Bruce made his way to Glasgow to visit the bishop, and surprisingly, or maybe not, the bishop absolved him of the murder and urged those in attendance to support Bruce. His excommunication was reversed, and the bishop escorted Bruce to the Scone, and there they were met by the Bishop of St. Andrews and several other Scottish nobles. And it was there, on 25 March 1306, Robert the Bruce was crowned King Robert I of Scotland. And this begins the second phase of the First War of Scottish Independence. Bruce would fight 2 more battles against Comyn's supporters and win them both, the final battle taking place in 1308. And then there was a lull in the fighting from 1308 until the Battle of Bannockburn in 1314. But during that time, Bruce solidified his kingship, and he raised an army to help defeat the English. And then, in 1314, the English and the Scots face off at the Battle of Bannockburn. Now, we're not going to get into the details of the battle in this lesson. The next lesson is dedicated solely to the battle itself. But like the other major battles, the Scots were outnumbered again. But they were able to beat the odds and the English. Now, Bannockburn was a monumental victory for Robert the Bruce and for Scotland. See, King Edward had died in 1307, and his son, King Edward II, was commanding the English army at Bannockburn. With the English defeated, Edward II retreated so he wouldn't be captured by the Scots. Now, for all intents, like I said, the Battle of Bannockburn was the end of the First War of Scottish Independence. But it took over 14 years for the two sides to finally sit down and negotiate a treaty. Now, from Bannockburn until the Treaty of Edinburgh and Northampton, there were 8 battles fought between England and Scotland. Scotland won 7 of those battles. The first 5 were fought from 1315 to 1320, and the Scots were able to stay unified and defeat the English in all 5 battles. And then in 1320, 51 Scottish nobles signed a Declaration of Scottish Independence, the Declaration of Arbroath, and they sent it to Pope John the 22nd. Robert the Bruce and a group of Scottish bishops sent their own letters to the Pope declaring the independence of Scotland as well. Now, a copy of this declaration is still stored at the National Archives of Scotland in Edinburgh, and the original is lost to the ages. But here's a passage from the Declaration of Arbroath showing just how dedicated these men were to their freedom and their independence from England.
For as long as but 100 of us remain alive, never will we on any conditions be brought under English rule. It is in truth not for glory, nor riches, nor honours that we are fighting, but for freedom. For that alone, which no honest man gives up, but with life itself.
After the declaration was delivered to the Pope, it would take another 8 years for any formal treaty to take place. And there were a few more battles during the time, all won by the Scots. But the English were having a bit of trouble on the home front themselves, and Scotland was one of the least of her problems. Now, after the death of Edward I, his son Edward II ruled the kingdom. Only Edward II was nothing like his father. He was an ineffective king, he was soundly defeated at Bannockburn, and eventually he'd be deposed by his own wife and her lover. So Edward II married Isabella of France, the she-wolf of France. Only he wasn't really interested in her. He liked his friend and favorite, Piers Gaveston. Now, it's rumored that the king and Piers were lovers. Some people like to debate that, but it's pretty clear that the two of them were very close, maybe too close. Now, during Edward's reign, he had more domestic issues to deal with than to worry about foreign policy and foreign issues with Scotland. After Bannockburn, England was hit with the Great Famine. Now, the Great Famine started with bad weather in early 1315. The harvest in 1315 was sparse. All crops failed to produce. Now, the trend continued into 1316 and 17. And the harvest in 1317 finally saw an upturn in crop production, but the effects of the famine lasted until about 1322. So food prices rose as a result of the limited supply, and people were unable to afford bread. In some areas, the price of food rose over 300%. The population of England was weakened and diseased from the lack of food. And it's estimated that the Great Famine killed over 15% of the population in England alone. Now, if the famine wasn't enough for Edward to deal with, in the early 1320s, he was faced with a civil war, which is referred to as the Despenser War. Now, the opposition to Edward was Roger Mortimer, who hated Hugh Despenser the Younger and his father, dubbed the Elder Despenser. So Despenser the Younger was a favorite of the king now, and the Despenser family had great influence over Edward. Now, Mortimer and his men revolted, and the Despenser War raged on for about a year. Mortimer was captured and imprisoned in the Tower of London, but he escaped in 1323 and then fled to London and joined Queen Isabella. Mortimer and Isabella gained the support of her brother, who happened to be King Charles IV of France. And with the support, they invaded England and deposed Edward. They executed the Despenser family, and they ruled the kingdom as regents to Isabella's son, the future Edward III. So back to Scotland and England. Finally, in March of 1328, the two sides, England and Scotland, came together to work out a peace treaty. It was the Treaty of Edinburgh and Northampton. Now, it wasn't Edward II that signed this treaty for England. It was his son, Edward III. Well, it was actually regents of Edward III, because Isabella and Mortimer were still ruling in his name at this time. Now, in the treaty, England agreed that Scotland was an independent nation, and Robert the Bruce and his heirs were the rightful rulers. And the treaty also set up the marriage of Joanna, the 6-year-old sister of Edward III, to David, the 4-year-old son of King Robert the Bruce. And they were married in less than 4 months, in July of 1328. And they remained married right up until Joanna's death in 1362. Not a bad deal for Scotland, and all for the low, low price of £100,000 sterling. Now in today's 2014 dollars, that's about 55 million US or 32 million pounds. So the treaty ended the First War of Scottish Independence, and it guaranteed Scottish independence for the next 400 years. Wait, what? I know, you're asking, what about the Second War of Scottish Independence? Well, that war dragged on for 25 years, with only 6 battles fought. That's like one battle every 4 years. It's not a war, that's like the Olympics. It's like, oh crap, it's time to go again. I'll be back in a little bit, honey, we gotta go fight the English. But the Second War ended the same as the first, with a treaty proclaiming that Scotland was a free and independent nation. Now, the Scottish nobles of the First War, men like Douglas, de Moray, Robert the Bruce, and the legendary William Wallace, they laid the foundation of resistance that carried over to the next generation and sustained a nation. Scotland would remain free of English rule until 1707, when the Treaty of Union created the Kingdom of Great Britain, which unified England and Scotland. Now, at the beginning, I mentioned that the Scottish referendum, which is up for a vote in September, if it passes, Scotland would once again be an independent country, free of English rule. Now, this sounds like a good thing, but it might be one of those be careful what you wish for, you just might get it moments. On the surface, it looks good, Scotland, free of English rule, but there's going to be a lot of negotiations to make this transition smooth. I mean, Scotland's going to need currency, they're going to need a military, infrastructure. I mean, the UK has socialized healthcare, Scotland's going to need to have that in place. And then there's a question of, will treaties like NATO carry over to the new nation of Scotland, or will they have to come up with new treaties and alliances? Now, I'd imagine the transition on something like this could go on for years. And then there's an interesting aspect, is if Scotland will also declare a new king or queen. There's a lot of questions on this, but keep your eyes on Scotland this September and see which way the people vote.
The Scottish Government is setting out what an independent Scotland could look like, including how it will raise taxes, create a defence force, and whether it will still be part of the EU. Scots will go to the polls on Thursday, the 18th September. There are two campaigns, Yes Scotland, backed by the SNP and the Scottish Greens, and Better Together, backed by Labour, the Conservatives and the Lib Dems. People living in Scotland are eligible to vote, and Scots in the armed forces overseas, but not Scots living in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. Also, for the first time in any UK poll, Scots aged 16 and 17 will be able to vote. The question being asked is, should Scotland be an independent country? The voting options are straightforward, yes or no. Independence would happen on the 24th of March, 2016.
That's going to end our look at the fight for Scottish independence. If you want to read more about the war or Bannockburn or just Scotland in general, you can find a lot of books on Audible. Audible is offering listeners of Medieval Archives podcast a free audiobook. Head on over to medievalarchives.com/audiobook, sign up for your free trial, and pick up a great history of Scotland, or really grab any book you want. Audible has a library of over 100,000 books to choose from, so you can pick up anything you like. It's free to sign up, you can cancel at any time, and the book is yours to keep free forever. Again, that's medievalarchives.com/audiobook, and thanks for the support. All right, what are your thoughts? Are the Scottish nobles national heroes? Was William Wallace as great as everyone says he is? Did Robert the Bruce lead his army on to victory and secure Scottish independence? Or was it the ineptness of King Edward II? Send your comments and questions to podcast@medievalarchives.com or leave a message on the listener voicemail line, 720-722-1066. Now, to keep up to date with all things medieval and any other major anniversaries that are coming up this year, please consider signing up for our newsletter at medievalarchives.com/subscribe. You don't want to miss out. Now, if you're enjoying the podcast, the easiest way to support is to tell your friends. If you're listening on your smartphone, you can send them a link right now. The second easiest way is to go over to iTunes and leave a rating. You can leave your rating or review by visiting medievalarchives.com/iTunes. Now, if you feel you want to support even more, you can always give a donation at medievalarchives.com/donate. Any amount is appreciated, and it helps keep the podcast and website running. And don't forget to check out that website. It's at medievalarchives.com. Thanks for your time. Thanks for your continued support. And that's going to wrap up another lesson for this week. So thanks again for subscribing and listening to the Medieval Archives Podcast, illuminating the dark ages for the digital world.
The Medieval Archives Podcast, the podcast for medieval news, history, and entertainment. If you have any questions, comments, topic ideas, or would like to sponsor an episode, send an email to podcast@medievalarchives.com. Audio files are welcome. You can call in your question or comment to 720-722-1066. International and long-distance charges may apply. Visit Medieval Archives at medievalarchives.com. You can also follow Medieval Archives on Facebook at facebook.com/medievalarchives and on Twitter at twitter.com/medievalarchive for all your daily medieval updates.